Reaching volumes of up to 108 decibels, the Yellow Wall cheers on Borussia Dortmund at its home games in Signal Iduna Park. With a capacity of 81,360, it's one of the largest football stadiums in Europe. The foundations for the stadium were laid in 1971. During major modifications carried out in 1995, a Liebherr LG 1550 lattice boom crane from Fricke Schmidbauer installed the large steel girders for the roof. Welcome to the second edition of Upload. Here I'm standing on an LG 1750, the successor of the LG 1550. Klaus, we build lots of LG 1750 cranes here at the plant every year. How did somebody actually come up with the idea of building a lattice boom on a mobile crane chassis?
We hold very close talks with every one of our customers, looking for the perfect crane design for each one of them. Perfect in terms of maximum lifting capacity, low number of transport cycles on site, and easy setup on site. A telescopic mobile crane is the obvious choice to satisfy all these criteria. However, due to their very design with a telescopic boom, these cranes have their limits in terms of lifting capacity. A lattice boom can generate significantly higher lifting capacities.
So, what are the general differences between a lattice boom crane and a crawler crane?
The advantages of a lattice boom crane involve transporting it to the site and setting it up on site. A crawler crane is transported in various components, so it takes a good deal of assembly work at the site. A mobile crane can be driven straight to the site and set up very easily on arrival. A crawler crane delivers the massive benefit that I can move the crane on the site as required with loads, which means that the crane is more flexible to use. Therefore, a crawler crane is ideal for long-term sites, whilst a mobile crane is more suitable for short, difficult jobs or for wind farm sites where the crane can be moved from turbine to turbine.
Thank you, Klaus. A very exciting development that has come about with the help of customers. And we'll take a look later at exactly what a crane of this type can do. Cranes build places where we can then spend our leisure time, all over the world. The only question is, am I actually authorized to operate a crane anywhere in the world? There's no uniform global standard around the world, like the International Driving License. In some countries, there are fixed regulations and certificates, while the training periods extend from a few days up to 3 years. The European Crane Operators License, ECOL, currently being developed, should be a step in the right direction. Christoph, you're our training manager and expert in crane operators licenses. Why are they needed?
Safety is paramount for us, and that does not just mean the crane itself, but also its safe operation. Our range of courses includes a series of different basic and advanced training for crane operators.
Who's behind the European Crane Operators License, and when can I start my training?
ESTA is the organization responsible for the European Crane Operators License since 2013.
It's also interesting that the British Columbia Association for Crane Safety in Canada is the first non-European country to acknowledge the ECOL.
Correct. A whole host of different countries already have crane operators licenses. The USA, for example, has the NCCCO, which provides a license accepted in several states.
Then let's hope that things continue moving forward in the interest of safety. Cranes are used to hoist large loads all over the world, and so our cranes are also regularly used for shipbuilding, including several times a year in the famous Meyer Werft in Papenburg. The reason is relatively straightforward. Ever larger ships, which have to be completed in ever shorter times, are made up of an ever greater number of components. These components are assembled and then hoisted into the right position by our mobile cranes. In the summer, one of the cranes carrying out this work was an LG 1750, tasked to hoist a fully assembled glass roof, 30 meters wide, 40 meters long, and weighing 138 tons, including slinging equipment, onto a brand new cruise ship. The difficulty was keeping the 20 slinging points evenly loaded. They all had to be loaded simultaneously using a yoke with tension chains. The ship's actually been moved out of the dock here, so it can be built more quickly, which is why you can currently see only one third of the new cruise ship. The glass roof, which was assembled outdoors, cannot be assembled in the shop because the shop is too low for it.
I'm a fan of the LT1750 because it can be used for so many different jobs. It is very compact for its size. It has very good lifting capacities.
A crane operator being authorized to operate a crane is one thing. Getting the crane to where it's actually needed is quite another. What difficulties does that involve? Here I am in our dispatch area, inside a lattice section. With me are Benjamin, our dispatch manager, our commercial director Mario Trunzer, and our customs expert Michael. Benjamin, where is this lattice section being shipped to?
It's part of an LR11000. Later we'll be shipping it to the USA via Bremerhaven.
What are the special aspects of the shipment process?
Every year we deliver around 2,000 cranes and more than 70,000 spare part consignments to customers all over the world. German customers generally pick up their cranes themselves from the factory. We deliver cranes to other European countries and overseas, direct to the customer, to a site or to our local branch companies. In addition to road, we also use rail and waterways.
A high proportion of our product is exported, and we deliver our cranes to every exotic corner of the world. But this does not happen by accident. It needs sophisticated export procedures and proper export controls. Our team is able to do all this work on a very professional basis.
What are the actual challenges involved?
At the moment, one of the biggest challenges is infrastructure and the steadily increasing regulations relating to transporting our cranes resulting from it. Bridge loads, driving time restrictions, and the compulsory escort vehicles from private companies or the police are just a few examples of this.
This is a problem because we are located here in the south of Germany, in Upper Swabia, and we have to get our cranes to the seaports to export them around the world. That means that we have to drive through the whole of Germany. The problem for us now is the infrastructure, above all the dilapidated bridges. We have to take diversions, which are expensive both economically and ecologically, costing us almost 1 million euros per year. On the other hand, we have cranes which we have designed and built so that we can drive them with different, lower axle loads, a massive benefit for our customers.
Michael, I assume these international shipments also involve customs regulations.
Of course, including certificates of origin, customs tariff numbers and embargo regulations, as well as export licenses. And we have to comply with all of them. Initially, we have to carry out a great deal of checks in the customs department to obtain all the foreign trade details. All the data are then collated and sent to the German customs authority. After they have been reviewed by the authority, we obtain final approval and they provide us the so-called export accompanying document. The work required is almost the same whether we are exporting an LR13000 or a small screw. The rule of thumb is that if an error is made during the customs procedure, the entire shipment could be stopped.
Benjamin, what was your most interesting shipment project?
That was definitely the delivery of an LR11350 to Bangladesh, involving special transport vehicles in Germany and outside, including assembly on the site and a handover process to the customer. Investigating the transport facilities and routes locally, involving around 50 bridges and roads which had been partly washed away by monsoons, took several months on its own. But ultimately, we delivered and assembled the crane on schedule and handed it over to a satisfied customer.
And the unique thing about this whole process was that he personally investigated every pothole on the route from the port to the site to ensure that the whole thing ran smoothly.
That just shows once again that without the professional attitude of our shipment and customs departments, the whole thing would just be impossible. So now it's time for us to go. And actually, we're going to France, or more accurately, to Paris. In the next edition, we'll be looking at what a sailing boat was doing up the Eiffel Tower. And we'll be looking forward to a brand new mobile crane, the LTM 1120 4.1. See you soon!